Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to today's Lincoln Learn session. My name is Connor Clancy. I am a manager in the Investment Management Group here in Deloitte, Dublin, and I would like to welcome you to our 2015 Lincoln Learn session. Lincoln Learn session, Introduction to Hedge Funds. Just a couple of housekeeping points before we get started. You can submit questions at any time during the presentation using the chat function, feature function, which is located at the bottom right-hand corner of the screen. We will have time at the end to answer some of these questions. If we don't get time to answer your questions, we will respond to you directly by email after the presentation. I'm today presenting the session together with Hervé Hons. Hervé is a manager in the Tax and Consulting Group in Luxembourg. Our discussion today is on the introduction to hedge funds. The topics that we will cover in this session are alternative investments and hedge funds, the types of hedge fund strategies, and European alternative investment funds. Before jumping into hedge funds themselves, I think it would be worthwhile for us to set the scene and convey where exactly hedge funds fit in the overall picture. With this in mind, I want to briefly discuss alternative investments as a whole. So first, I'm going to start off with a definition of what is an alternative investment. Alternative investments are often defined not by what they are, but what they are not. An alternative investment is a position in something other than a long position in either equity or debt. So the alternative investment universe looks at all the investment strategies beyond traditional bond and equity. The alternative investment market includes the following: hedge funds, venture capital, private equity, and real estate.
Well, exactly. Just one more comment regarding the definition of alternative investments. There's actually no such a universe definition of alternative investments. And typically, we can break down alternatives in two buckets. The first one is funds using the same instruments, like UCITS, for example, equities, bonds, fixed income, but they will use it in a different way. So they will use non-traditional strategies. That's the first one. And the second bucket is actually they use non-traditional asset classes, as typically private equity, real estate, commodities. So it's really two groups. First group is instruments, regular instruments, but used in a non-traditional way. And the second group is really different kind of asset classes. It's really important that hedge funds are not necessarily investing in a very different instrument than UCITS, but you will use instruments in a different way. But we will be covering different strategies in the second sections. But just bear in mind, it is very important that hedge funds do not necessarily invest in very exotic instruments. They do, and they will invest mainly in listed liquid instruments. That's one thing I wanted to add on this.
Thanks, Hervé. I just wanted to, are you able to move on to slide 5?
You have the right, actually, to move the slides.
No. Apologies here, people. We seem to be stuck on slide 4.
Mm.
here we go. Sorry, I'm on to.
Okay. Can you change the slide? I'm not able to actually.
Slide five. I got it back. Thanks, everybody. Alternative investments are sophisticated investments that carry different risks to traditional investments, such as shares and property. Since the financial crisis, diversification has become key to good investing. And this is where alternative investments come in as they improve the risk and return pattern over a traditional portfolio. They do this by offering additional diversification, premium yields for taking on different risks. They improve risk return characteristics. Alternative assets managers possess flexibility to make investment decisions, and they also focus on absolute returns instead of relative returns. These are strategies that tend to perform well in any market situation.
One big caveat to these allegations about hedge funds is all the performance studies are actually based on the public database. And the public database actually populated, created by the managers, the hedge fund managers themselves. So basically, they contribute on a voluntary basis their own performance to the database. And of course, you have a strong incentive as a hedge fund manager to contribute your performance when your performance are very good. When they are not good, you will not contribute. So as a result of this, you create what we call a selection bias, meaning that the people, the funds contributing to the database are the top performing usually. So when it comes to performance computation, you will actually compute the performance from a non-representative sample because these hedge funds are top performing and are not necessarily representative actually of the universe. So what we introduce what we call a selection bias. Another bias is actually when a hedge fund goes bust, means it explodes, it will typically be removed from the database. So what's left is again the best performing, and it introduces another bias, what we call survivorship bias, meaning that you only take into account in your computation all the funds having survived up to a moment. And when you combine everything, actually your performance is overstated. And the same way, in a similar fashion, your volatility, so your risk, is also understated. So when people say, well, hedge funds outperform, you need to be careful about this, because on average, the performance figures they will come up with are not representative. So on a case-by-case basis, it's possible that your hedge fund manager will outperform. But on average, it's not necessarily true. So pay attention that all the studies are made from databases which are not necessarily representative of the universe. So it's a very big caveat you need to be aware of.
Okay, thanks, Irving. Now on to slide six here, hedge funds. I'm now going to focus on one type of alternative investment, which is hedge funds. So what actually is a hedge fund? Having researched articles and presentations on the subject, I've concluded that there is no standard definition, but the key points that keep coming up are hedge funds' ability to short the market, to leverage the portfolio, and to hold high concentrations of positions. That primarily distinguishes hedge funds from other investment vehicles. What primarily distinguishes hedge funds from other investment vehicles is the investment strategy. However, there are no industry-wide classifications of hedge funds strategies, and each major industry group has its own classification system. So now I'm going to look at some of the main attractions of hedge funds. Firstly, there is an expectation of strong returns, which you will see later on in some of the graphs that we will cover in the presentation. Many hedge funds employ a strategy known as short selling, which involves a fund selling a security that it does not own. The investment manager expects the security to decrease in value, and in such an event, when the security is bought back, the fund will have gained from that transaction. This transaction involves a fund borrowing the security from the prime broker, selling it short, and hoping to repurchase the security at a lower price than delivering the security back to the lender. the use of this strategy and additional strategies, which we will cover later on, gives the investment manager the possibility of achieving gains from investments in situations where the market in general has decreased in value, and this is one of the main attractions of hedge funds. Other attractions of hedge funds include low correlations to traditional asset classes and ability to provide diversification. Another attraction is hedge funds have strategies that tend to perform well in any market situation. And another attraction is relative liquidity compared to other alternative investments. Now, just to discuss some of the misconceptions of hedge funds. One of the misconceptions is all hedge funds are risky investments. This is not the case. First of all, no investment comes without a certain degree of risk. Just as the traditional funds, risk and potential return depends on the particular strategy which the fund employs. Many funds have low degree of risk inherent in their strategies and are higher leveraged. While some hedge funds have produced returns which are below investor expectations, statistics show that from 1994 to 2015, hedge funds on average, using the Dow Jones Credit Suisse Hedge Fund Index, outperformed traditional markets. But again, as Hervé just said, because of survivorship bias and selection bias, these statistics are skewed. Another misconception is that hedge funds are very illiquid. Yes, some hedge funds are less liquid than others, or in fact, even invest in illiquid securities such as distressed debt. One of the main reasons for less liquid redemption terms is where returns even for liquid securities are expected to be realized over a longer time horizon. However, the majority of hedge funds actually invest in highly liquid instruments. Most liquid strategies are typically long, short, equity, and managed futures. Now we will look at some of the differences between hedge funds and traditional funds. From a high level, one of the main differences between traditional and hedge fund investments is that for hedge funds, it is the skill of the manager rather than the performance of a market or an asset class that drives returns. At a more detailed level, one of the main differences is that hedge funds use prime brokers. Why does a hedge fund use a prime broker? Well, due to the diverse nature of instruments within hedge fund managers often trade with a number of brokers who specialize in certain types of securities. Fund's prime broker provides a consolidation service, which means that executing brokers are instructed to settle all trades with this prime broker. This simplifies trade settlement and reporting as all trade information is centralized with one broker. The prime broker's role has evolved with the growth of hedge fund industry, and it provides a number of services that include, and I've listed them out there, for the first one, clearance. So the prime broker provides confirmation of transactions with clients' counterparties. Prime broker also provides custody of the securities. Prime broker collects information, monitoring corporate actions such as dividend payments and proxy-related information, and provides it to the investment managers so they can make informed decisions about what they will do in the particular transaction. They also provide research, which providing cash and position reports. Another one, financing loans. The prime broker provides the hedge fund can employ tactics of leverage. Prime broker also allows stock lending to cover short sales. Other differences are now the fee structures. So I'll talk about the fee structures of the hedge funds in a little bit. The hedge fund management firms typically charge their funds both a management fee and a performance fee. Management fees are calculated as a percentage of the fund's net asset value, typically ranging from 1% to 4% per annum, with 2% being standard. They're usually expressed as an annual percentage, but calculated and paid monthly or quarterly. Management fees for hedge funds are designed to cover the operating costs of the manager, whereas the performance fee provides the manager's profits. The performance fee is typically 20% of the fund's profits during any year. Performance fees, as the name suggests, are intended to provide an incentive for a manager to generate profits. Almost all hedge fund performance fees include a high watermark or loss carry forward provision, which means that the performance fee only allows to net profits. And what I mean by that is profits after losses in previous years have been recovered. This prevents managers from receiving fees for volatile performance. Some performance fees include a hurdle so that a fee is only paid on funds performance in excess of the benchmark rate, for example, the LIBOR rate or another fund index. A hurdle is intended to ensure that a manager is only rewarded if the fund generates returns in excess of the returns that the investor would have received if they had invested their money elsewhere. Some hedge funds charge a redemption fee or withdrawal fee for early withdrawals during a specified period of time, typically a year, or when withdrawals exceed a predetermined percentage of the original investment. The purpose of the fee is to discourage short-term investing, reduce turnover, and deter withdrawals after periods of poor performance. Unlike management fees and performance fees, redemption fees are usually kept by the fund themselves. On to point number two, their lock-in period. Shareholders who invest in hedge funds normally have to lock in their investment for a fixed period, which can range from 90 days to a year. During this period, the investor is prohibited from redeeming their investment from the fund. Number three, their redemption windows. Most hedge funds only allow their shares to be redeemed at fixed intervals during the year. Normally, this is quarterly. Therefore, an investor who wishes to sell their units on, for example, the 17th of January, just a random date, must wait until the end of the quarter, which in this case will be the 31st of March. And lastly, side pockets. So what is a side pocket? Where a hedge fund holds assets that are hard to value reliably or are relatively illiquid, the fund may employ a side pocket. A side pocket is a mechanism whereby the fund segregates the illiquid assets from the main portfolio of the fund and issues investors with a new class of shares which participate only in the assets of that side pocket. Those shares cannot be redeemed by the investor. Once the fund is able to sell the side pocket assets, the fund will generally redeem the side pocket shares and pay investors proceeds. Side pockets are most commonly used by funds as an emergency measure. They were used extensively following the collapse of Lehman Brothers in 2008, when the market for certain types of assets held by hedge funds collapsed, preventing the funds from selling or obtaining a market value for the assets.
Side pockets were also used for Madoff exposures. So they were typically put in side pockets, and if after years the fund could recover some money, then initial investor could recover part of the money. That's why Madoff funds were put typically in side pockets. That's also one use of side pockets.
Okay, thanks, Eric. So lastly here, I just want to show you a fund diagram of the various different service providers involved in the workings of a fund. Now, this has been discussed in previous Link and Learn sessions. If you dialed into Introduction to Funds, they would have gone through this in more detail. But I just thought it was important to point out what's going on here. Obviously, the next few slides describe each of these positions, but maybe if I just stay on this slide and talk about it a bit. So maybe if we just start off with the Board of Directors, similar to other funds, the Board of Directors are those charged with governance. And in order for the various different functions of the jobs, they need to employ service providers, such as administrators, investment managers, prime brokers, transfer agents, and the like. The Board of Directors are those charged with governance, and each of the service providers report to the Board of Directors at each board meeting, probably quarterly. So I suppose just to go through each of the functions here, the investment manager is obviously quite self-explanatory. He that is the entity that provides the investment services to the fund. So within the fund strategy and within the goal set out in the prospectus and the legal documents, the investment manager makes investments within those restrictions with the goal of making an absolute return. The investment manager makes his investments, and they're held in custody, as we just explained previously, with the prime broker. The administrator takes account of all of these transactions going on. And if somebody wants to subscribe or redeem out of the fund, they go through the transfer agent. But I suppose one point to point out here is the investment manager makes a transaction and makes a note of it and records it in their books. The prime broker receives these securities and records it in their books. And the administrator needs to do a three-party reconciliation where they receive the documents from the investment manager, a report at the end of the month or whenever they strike their NAV. They also receive a record from the prime broker, a statement monthly or whenever they strike their NAV. And before they strike their NAV, they need to reconcile and do a three-way reconciliation, compare the two reports, one from the investment manager, one from the prime broker, and reconcile any differences before they strike their NAV. And there, on these slides, similarly just discussed what I've outlined there. If an investor has any difficulty or any complaint about the fund, they would go back to the board of directors as they are the ones charged with governance. So they still hold responsibility despite allocating the functions out to the various service providers. The administrator will prepare the accounts similarly once they strike the NAV. Then I think I'm going to hand over to Hervé now.
Yes, thank you. So different type of hedge fund structure we can encounter in practice is the first one we typically have is a fund of hedge funds. And as the name suggests, a fund of hedge funds is a fund investing in different funds, simply. The key advantage is, of course, diversification. You can hold tens of hedge funds, so you hedge against risk, individual risk of each single hedge fund. That's the first advantage. The second one is, of course, expertise, because typically boutique of fund of hedge funds will have connections in the fund industry world that you cannot get in personally. So they will meet in person the different hedge funds. They will try to source new hedge funds. So they will provide you access to a broader and a larger number of hedge funds. That's typically the key advantage. But of course, there are also drawbacks. And the main one to me is really the fee structure. Because as was explained earlier in the presentation, the fee structure of funds is management fees plus performance fees. So you need at the fund level, but you need to add another layer of fees at the fund of hedge funds. So we typically had at least 1% of management fees plus typically 10 to 15% of performance fees. So when you combine all the fees, you end up with a very low performance. And that's typically the performance of fund of hedge fund is very low compared to the markets. But at least you get an exposure to hedge funds, and you get limited downside risk. Next structure is what we call managed account. And managed account is an account which is dedicated to one investor or a few investors. So it's very different than the funds. You can have tens or even thousands of investors. Here you have only one or two investors. And the goal is actually to have an exposure to a strategy which is specific to you. For example, if you want to have an exposure to a strategy in emerging markets, but with a specific adaptation for you, you might go to an asset manager and say, "Oh, look, I'm interested in your investment strategy, but I would like you to change this and this because I don't like this in your strategy. For example, I don't like your short IDs. I would like only long IDs." And so one possibility is to open a managed account with this manager, and the asset manager will manage the strategy adapted to your needs in this managed account. So it's extremely flexible, but you need to have quite a lot of money to invest, because typically if you go to an asset manager, they will not open a managed account for $1 or $2 million. They will ask more. Why? Because simply they need to allocate more resources to manage this account. Another advantage is the transparency. Typically, you will have a view on the portfolio every day. So if you compare to a regular single hedge funds, if you ask to get a view on this portfolio, it's quite difficult. It might get you his portfolio, but typically with a lag of a few weeks or even a few months. But with a managed account, it's possible to get the portfolio on a daily basis. So it's very transparent and very good also for risk management, because you get all the exposure in real time. Last is, of course, very common, is a single manager hedge fund, which we talk about. Typically, there is a minimum subscription amount. Typically, it can amount up to $1 million USD. That's a huge difference with fund of hedge funds. Typically, fund of hedge funds, they pool money, and so they can invest in the name on behalf of a large number of investors. Here, if you want to invest directly into a single manager hedge fund, you need to come with a very high investment. So that's a big drawback. That's why retail investors are typically not allowed to invest, is because the entry ticket is very high. So you need to be wealthy to be able to invest directly in hedge funds. One key thing we see in practice is ETF tracking hedge fund strategies. Typically, we see this with Deutsche Bank, and also with Société Générale, so Lyxor. How it is done in practice? Well, you can get exposure to a specific hedge funds or to a specific basket of hedge funds through a certificate or a total return swap. And how is it constructed? It's actually constructed with a managed account. So typically, a hedge fund, if you are interested in a manager, in a specific manager, he will typically open a managed account with, for example, Deutsche Bank, DB Select, and he will manage the money into that managed account. And you will get an exposure to that strategy through a certificate or a total return swap tracking the value of the managed account. So that's typically what we see now as a new trend, is ETF tracking hedge funds, and it's actually achieved through a managed account. So that's another way to use managed accounts. Okay. We will now go into more depth of the different strategies of the hedge funds. First, it's not easy to come with a very rigid and strict classification of the different strategies. Why? Because actually, by definition, hedge fund strategies are specific to the investment manager. He has developed some investment skills over time, so it's not easy to put every hedge fund in one single bucket. There's typically some overlap between them. But as a rule, we try to break down the strategies as follows. The first group is what we call directional. So managers that will try to make money by betting on the direction of a stock or on an asset in general. And the first type of strategy we have, which is very, very common in practice, I'm sure you heard of, is what we call global macro. Global macro, as the name suggests, is really going as using a top-down approach. So the investment manager will go and will look at the world in general. So it will look at the different economies, markets in the world. For example, it might look at the commodities price, it might look at the interest rates in US, Europe, Asia, equities, etc. So it's really taking a top view approach. And then when it decides for an investment theme, it will go into more details. It will go into the construction of the portfolio itself. So it will select stocks to play its investment theme. I give you just a quick example, which is very relevant to in the current market. The oil price has gone down for quite significantly. That's one. That will be the theme that the investment manager will play. How do you play the oil price decline? Well, there are typically many ways. But one way will be to, for example, to short stocks. Okay, short stocks. Which one? Well, I will look, for example, at the most leveraged, so meaning at the most indebted companies. So, for example, I will go and look for U.S. companies investing in shale gas. Why shale gas? Because it cost a lot. They invested a lot to extract gas from shale. So they took a lot of money. They borrowed a lot of money to invest to finance the investment. So typically, if oil goes down, these stocks will be hurt badly. Why? Because they are leveraged and they need a high price of oil to be viable. So this is typically the approach that a manager will follow. They identify first a trend, oil going down, then they decide how to play. They will short the market, US stock, oil stocks, which one specific with a high leverage ratio to short them. How do you short stock? It's a good question. As I was explained in the early presentation, the first one is, of course, stock borrowing, where you borrow the stock from prime broker and you sell it to the market. That's the traditional way of doing shorting, but there are other ways. And one big drawback of stock borrowing is what we call the squeeze. The squeeze is when you borrow the stock, at some point in time, you may be recalled the stock. Why? Because the funds you borrow from need the stock, so you may be forced to buy it back just to give it back to the prime broker. And you might be forced at the wrong time. So that's what we call the squeeze of stock lending. So to overcome that problem, there are other ways to short stock. One way, which is very common, is what we call put options. A put options allow you to sell stock, in this case, or any assets at a predefined price, which is called a strike, at maturity, or before maturity if it's American options. But the key point here is actually you are replicating a short position in the stock. That's one alternative to short stock. A third way we see more and more is what we call CFD, which stands for contract for difference, which is basically very similar to a futures. The key difference with the futures is first, it's an OTC contract. So you will need to transact with a counterparty, not with an exchange. And there is no maturity. It's very important. There is no maturity, unlike futures. But the concept is the same. You put up initial margin, typically ranging from 10% to 20%, and you control 5 times the amount of the stock. So you are in a position to short the stock with some leverage. And that's a very effective way to short stocks. And there's no short problems or short risks. So like I said, global macro is very, very broad in terms of assets. So it might invest in commodities, currencies, bonds. So it's quite liquid. So as I said at the very beginning, it will use very similar instruments, so like stocks, but in a non-traditional way. So it will go long, but it will also go short. That's a very key difference with UCITS. So liquidity, well, it depends on the funds. So it's typically liquid, but it really depends on the fund you have. And it's extremely volatile. Pay attention also, you get sometimes return and standard deviation per strategy. As I said at the beginning, you have all the bias, survivorship and selection, but also among the different funds, you have a lot of variety, difference in performance. So you might have an average of 10%, but the top may be much higher and the bottom much lower. So there's a lot of range within the same bucket of strategy. Any other comments to add? Connor, you want to add a few comments to this?
No, not particularly. Everything
okay.
We explained everything. Thanks, Hervé.
Okay. Next one is actually what we call managed futures or CTA, commodity trading advisors. It's typically a fund investing in futures, typically in futures, based on some algorithm. So the most famous funds you will see probably in most fund of hedge funds is a Winton Futures. The name is Winton Futures. And actually, it invests both in commodity stocks through futures based on some of mathematical formulae. So I give you just a quick example of formula, which is, in practice, it's much more complicated, but just to give you some example, you will buy the stock index is a 21 moving average is above the 40 period moving average. That's typically one thing they do. That's one algorithm. So typically, the buy and sell signals are generated based on some mathematical formula. And it might sometimes be completely automated, so meaning that the sell and buy orders will be automatically sent by a machine, by a computer. And of course, the extreme version of this is what we call high frequency. And high frequency is say, okay, they buy stocks several times in a second. So it's really extreme case, but typically CTA, the holding period will be from a couple of minutes to a couple of weeks, even months. So the holding period is quite short, but the key point here is really that the buy and sell signals are generated from an algorithm. The key point also is because they invest in futures, futures are liquid, right? They're relatively liquid. So the liquidity of the funds of managed futures is very high, and it's typically the most liquid strategies. So for some funds, you might see a daily variation. So it's possible to get a daily redemption notice. So that's typically what we can see. Of course, similar to global macro, they go long and short. That's very, very important for them to be long and short. It performs extremely well in extreme markets. So when there is a lot of volatility, like we experienced in August this year, typically these funds will outperform the market. Why? Because they are directional. And if you want to make money, being directional, you need the stock market to move. If the stock market doesn't move, you don't make any money. Of course, if you are wrong on the direction, you will lose a lot of money. But if you are right about the direction of the market, you will make a lot of money. But the key point to make money in the you need a lot of volatility. That's why this kind of funds will typically outperform the market on a risk-adjusted basis, of course, when the market is volatile. A third strategy is what we call emerging markets. Emerging markets is actually, as the name suggests, is the investment manager has some expertise in local markets, because typically in emerging markets you have under-researched companies because there are not a lot of analyst coverage. And these guys, these funds, have a hedge because they know the companies, they know the countries, they have connections. So they know and they will identify undervalued companies. So there is typically a long-only fund. We don't see a lot of short. Why? Because shorting in emerging markets is typically not allowed. And the derivatives market is not as developed as in developed markets. Typically, long, might be short sometimes, but the vast majority of the positions is long. And the key advantage of these funds is to find companies which are completely unknown to the public. And these funds get paid to invest in these companies. Of course, the drawback is typically the risk, because when there are more risk linked to the emerging markets, for example, currencies. Currencies, you really have to invest in local currencies. And these may be devalued by the government, so you have a lot of more currency risk. That's the first risk you have. Second is liquidity. Sometimes it may be not possible to sell your position. As an example, during August in China, the market plummeted and the government limited the sales of positions. So even if you wanted to get out of a position, you were not allowed to do so. So that's one more risk you need to carry. Of course, the other side is the returns. They typically achieve a higher return in compensation for the risk they take, but it's of course for the risk, the higher the risk they take. But typically, the key point you need to remember is they have a hedge because they know the market better, and they can find under research unknown companies. Okay. Equity long short. That's the most popular strategies. Why is it popular? Well, because actually a lot of people coming from the UCITS world were long only. And actually if you compare a long only to a long short, the only difference by definition is a short size. So if you can manage a long portfolio, it's not that difficult to add an extra portfolio with the short positions. And if you remember, as we explained at the early presentation, one key difference with UCITS in terms of compensation for the investment manager is the performance fees. And typically, the performance fees is much higher in the hedge fund world than UCITS. So if you can do the same job, meaning long only, and just add one extra layer of short, but get paid much higher, while you are quite motivated to move to the hedge fund world. That's why many people move from UCITS to the long short, because there is not a huge gap between skills and experience to run a long only versus a long short portfolio. That's why we see so many long short portfolio in the market. Of course, like I said in the beginning, the variability of performance is very high. So, I mean, a long short one is of a fund A might be very different than the long short of the fund B. So, potential to this. But the idea is what? Is of course to be long. Long, of course, as the name suggests, long positions, but also to profit, to take short positions to profit from stock price is going down. That's one way to play. Another way is to hedge. For example, if I have a long only, I may want to hedge against a market decline. So one way to do it is, for example, is to short futures. I have, for example, a portfolio invested in US. I expect some decline in the coming weeks. I want to short some futures on the S&P 500 to hedge my portfolio. That's a long short. And my short positions are not there to make money. They are there to protect my long positions. That's one way to play it. The second way, as I explained, is to make money on both sides. You make money on long short, or on the long side, sorry, but also you make money on the short positions. And the idea is to have some kind of balanced portfolio. Because if the markets go down, you will lose money on the long, but you will make money on the short. If the market goes up, you will make money on the long, but you will lose probably on the short. So your exposure, your net exposure, what we call in practice beta, is fairly limited. That's one key advantage of equity long short. Yes, do you want to add some comments, Connell?
No, Hervé, you're pretty much covering all my points there. That sounds good.
Perfect. One key difference also you will find among equity long short is the sectors. You will typically find people specializing in one or two sectors and also in geographic area. You will not get in long short investing in all the world. It's not common. That will be more global macro. So what we have is, for example, a fund being invested or specializing in biotech, US biotech. That's one possibility. So you will get some specialization in terms of sectors and geographical area. A variation of the long short is actually the short bias. Short bias is actually being short the stock market. To be honest with you, it's not the number of funds being short, net short, the vast majority of the time is not so common. Why? There's just a reason for this. The market on average, of course, will go up more often than down. So if you are short all time, you will lose money because just the market will go up. Of course, you can find names, specific names that will go down, but approximately 70% of the stocks, individual stocks, follow the general trend of the market, meaning that if you are short the whole time and the stock is up, there's a 70% chance that your stock you are short will go up. So you are really working, investing against the trends. Of course, what we see in practice is more in the context of a fund of hedge funds, you might have sometimes a fund dedicated to short bias. Why? Because you need sometimes a hedge, and they will provide a hedge against in downturn markets. So they will typically outperform the market when it goes down. So you might want to invest in this kind of funds when you expect the markets to go down. If, for example, I have a fund of hedge funds, I cannot go short futures. I want only to be invested in single hedge funds. You might want to use this kind of funds to hedge against downside risk. That's typically the way. But if you look at performance, this kind of funds has delivered a negative performance. Why? Because market is going up on average. Of course, on average, but over the years, it's going up. Okay, that's what for the first type of strategies we have is directional. The next one is what we call event-driven. As the name suggests, they will play specific events in the corporate life. The first one is distressed. Distress is when a company is under liquidation or is being reorganized. A fund might take a stake or either in equities, through inequities or through bonds. And the key point is to change the management, so they will take a more active role, they will change the board of directors, they will change the management, they will change the strategy to reshuffle the company and will try to sell the position with the profit. And here, it's really a strategy which has some overlap with private equities. Sometimes, hedge funds and private equities will compete for the same deals. For example, if you have you can have distressed in private equities, that's also possible. So this here, some overlap between hedge funds and private equities. But here, the key point is to reorganize the company and come out with a profit. Probability is very low, of course, because you are working with a default companies, but when they make money, they will typically make a lot of money. So probability of success low, but the reward is very high. Next event is what we call merger arbitrage, merger risk arbitrage. I just give an example. It's, let's say this is a stock of the company is trading at 100. And this stock is actually being acquired by another company at the price of 110. Typically, the price of the first company, the price will move from 100 to, for example, 109. It will not go directly to 110. Why? Because there is some possibility that the merger or the acquisition will not be achieved. Why? Because you need shareholders will not agree. There might be some regulation preventing from being the company A to be acquired. So there is some uncertainty, and this uncertainty will be reflected in the price. So what the hedge fund will do is they will go long the first stock. So they will buy the stock at 109. And to hedge against the market risk, they will short the stock of the company acquiring the first company. And if the deal is completed at the price of 110, what would happen is actually they will make money because they bought at 109 and they will sell the position at 110. Of course, if the deal collapses, it's not made, the stock will move from 109 back to the initial price of 100. So they will lose a lot of money. So here, if I compare to the first strategy, the probability of success is very high because they typically have a research analyst that will analyze the deal, the probability of the deal to be made. So the probability is typically very high, but when they make money, they don't make a lot of money. But if they lose, they will lose a lot of money. So it's kind of opposite of the first strategy. And if you look at the next slide, we have here the performance. And the performance of this strategy is quite low. It's achieved a cumulative performance over 5 years, about of 8%, which is a bit less than 2% a year. So it's quite small, but it's really consistent. They make regular money, but when they lose money, they lose typically big. Okay. Next. Arbitrage. Arbitrage, actually, if you go to the financial literature, what you will find is as a definition for arbitrage is it's actually locking in, guarantee a riskless profit by taking some combination of profits of positions. So you will lock a profit for sure by taking long and short position. That's typically the definition of arbitrage. In practice, the point is also to get to lock some profit, but the profit is not guaranteed. And you will see that in the different strategies that there's high chance of achieving that return. That means that there's high probability of making that small money, but there's also some risk that we not make it. That's a very key difference between arbitrage in theory and arbitrage in practice. Is that in practice, your max profit, your profit is not guaranteed. The first one, which is very common in practice, is the market neutral. A market neutral is actually a special case of long short. It's actually your position on the long will offset the position on your short. And the key is to have no market exposure, meaning when the market goes up, it will have no impact on the portfolio. So the key question, how do you make money? Of course, the risk of the security, how it moves, is affected by two things. The first is the market. Like I said, the stock is moving in the same direction 70% of the time when the market is up. But there's another factor, which is what we call specific risk. So specific to the stock itself. And I give you an example. I want to be short oil company again. I will take, for example, as an example, Petrobras, which is an oil Brazilian company. I want to short Petrobras. But I don't want any exposure to the oil because I just to be as neutral as possible, to be as low volatile as possible. How do I hedge? I will buy an ETF tracking the oil market. For example, Yuzo. The Yuzo ETF is tracking actually the US oil market. So my portfolio is long ETF and short Petrobras. What I did here is I remove the market risk from Petrobras. I remove the impact of the oil on Petrobras. And I expect Petrobras to go further down than the oil. So what is my residual risk is actually I expect Petrobras to go down further than the oil. Okay? And actually here is what we call is try to find companies that will outperform the market. So the risk, the idiosyncratic return is much higher than the general market. Okay. If you go to slide, it's actually delta neutral is what I referred. So I don't want any exposure to the market. I remove as much as I can, and I just want exposure to the specific return of the stocks itself. Okay. That's what we call arbitrage. It's not, as I explained, it's not guaranteed, because in my example, there is no guarantee that Petrobras will go down further, I mean, go down more than the oil itself. There's a high chance, I did some analysis, etc., but there is no guarantee that Petrobras will go down more than the oil. Okay, that's my key risk. And in practice, what we see is this kind of strategy is delivering very consistent return, very positive return on a consistent basis. But when they lose big. And that's why it's the strategy over time has not delivered very stable return. It's because it's very, very difficult to be perfectly neutral to the market. Why? Because, like I said, 70% of the stock is moving in the same direction of the market. So you need to be extremely good at removing this exposure into your positions. Of course, one thing which is very common to every arbitrage strategies is typically the return is very low. Because so how do you transform a low return into a high return? Well, you leverage, means you take out a loan, you borrow money to amplify, to leverage your return. So the vast majority of arbitrage funds will be leveraged. So meaning, of course, when your return are good, you will be positively leveraged, meaning you will make more money. But also, it works in reverse, meaning when you lose money, you lose much bigger. So it works in reverse. Convertible arbitrage is also a very extremely popular strategy. To get the idea, you need just to introduce the concept of convertible bond. Without going into much detail of a convertible bond is a regular bond, meaning it pays you coupon and notional at maturity, but with an extra kicker. And this kicker is actually the possibility to convert into stocks. So you may, at some point in time, say, look, I'm giving away your bond, and I change it against shares. And one is it at a fixed price, and it's very key, at a fixed price. So when it's interesting, well, of course, when the stock price is going up, you are actually, it's beneficial for you to convert your bond, because your bond, you receive only fixed coupon. So it's going to go up, you don't profit from the stock price. So you have a strong incentive to exchange your bond into shares. And if you look at the graph, actually it's the right part of the graph. When the stock goes up, actually the bond, the convertible bond, will behave like a stock, because you are actually, you are incentivized to convert your bond into shares. In the middle, well, it's kind of a hybrid instrument. It means it's a bit of a combination of stocks and bond. It will pay, it's very hybrid. And when stocks go down, up to a point, you will not be affected. Because why? Why? Because you prefer to be in a bond. You prefer to keep the cash from the bond, so you prefer to receive coupon and the bond itself. And as a notional, you don't want the stock. Up to a moment that when it's close to default, obviously the bond price will be also impacted. That's why if you go to the extreme left, the bond value will reflect actually the default value of the company. So in a nutshell, convertible bond is a very hybrid. It's a combination of a bond, a regular bond, and a stock. Sometimes it behaves like a stock. Sometimes it behaves like a bond. And if I come back now to the convertible arbitrage, what hedge fund manager will typically do is they want to remove the impact of the stock itself. So when the stock will go up, they want to remove the impact of the stock going up to the price of the convertible. How do they do that? They will short the stock. So they will have a portfolio with a long convertible, short the stock. So when the stock goes up, they will make money on the convertible bonds, and they will lose money on the short position. So the two positions will offset each other, and they will not make money on this. How do they make money at the end? Well, remember, the convertible is paying coupon. So you will have a position paying you coupon on a daily, on accrued basis, but with no or residual exposure. That's the key, what we call arbitrage in the convertible. So you will neutralize, you will kill the impact of the stock price into the convertible. And what you end up with is actually a coupon you received without any risk, well, in theory. Okay, that's the idea of convertible arbitrage. Fixed income arbitrage is actually very similar. Sometimes it's very specific here, but for example, you might have sometimes what we call in the US underrun and versus overrun treasuries. Underrun is actually the latest issue of the US government. While the off is a more is a holder version, and what in practice what we have is a spread. There is some liquidity premium on the on-run, meaning that the liquidity is the on-run treasuries are more liquid than the off-run. So, and of course, this liquidity premium is not constant over time, and at some point in time, they may be this liquidity may be high versus on a historical basis. So you might want to short one versus and being long the other to capture this higher spread. That's one example of fixed income arbitrage. There are a lot of more, which I will not cover into details because it's quite specific. The one is also mortgage. Mortgage typically will pay you a higher return for liquidity. So you might also want to capture this liquidity by investing in mortgage securities. The last, which is actually very important also in practice, is a multi-strategies. And multi-strategies is actually combining different strategies into one fund or into one account. And of course, the goal is actually to be diversified, because one strategy will typically outperform in one type of market, but other ones will not. So you might want to build a portfolio which is diversified into strategies, because you know that at some point, some will outperform while some will underperform. So it's really key. The key here as an investment manager is to be able to allocate dynamically your money to different strategies. If you have a view, for example, I'll give you an example. If you have a view that the volatility is going to increase, you might want to increase your position into CTA, because I explained earlier, these funds will get have a positive impact. The higher volatility have a positive impact on CTA on returns. For example, if you after 2009, 2010, there were a lot of distressed companies. So there were a lot of good opportunities for hedge fund managers to invest in distressed. And if you look 3-4 years after, the performance are very excellent. Why? Because the equity markets recovered and they were able to sell the position at a much higher price. So you see, depending on your view, you might want to change your portfolio to take advantage of your views on the market. Okay, and now hand back the floor to my colleague who will be covering the different structure, legal structure in Europe.
Thanks, Hervé. So I suppose we'll just wrap this up pretty quick. There's only a couple of similar structures here in Ireland and across Europe. The qualified alternative investment funds, and these two, the retail investment alternative funds, are really under the AIFMD framework. Mm-hmm. So retail investment funds, it's really replacing the old non-UCITS structures. Similar in type. And common contractual funds are open to investors for more tax transparency reasons. Have you any points there, Hervé?
Well, in Luxembourg, the key, well, one major vehicle is, of course, the special investment funds, Northern SIF, but you get also different structures like SPV, so special purpose vehicle, the SICAR, which is more for hedge funds, for private equities, but for hedge funds, one key vehicle is, of course, the SIF. I think you will have dedicated sessions, legal sessions, for the different structures. So we will not be covering into the details, but if you are interested into the legal aspects, there will be some sessions on the different vehicles available in the market for this kind of strategies.
Thanks, Hervé. So just on to the next slide, it's just where in the world where assets are managed in, well, this is 2013, but the vast majority of assets are managed in the US and in Europe. So I think we'll close up for the day. I want to thank you all for joining us on our LinkedIn Learn. Hopefully you're a little bit more informed now. I just want to remind you the next LinkedIn Learn is on Thursday, the 26th of November, and it's private equity, property funds, and real estate. So I'm sure that'll be a really good one. So I just want to thank Hervé for joining me as well on this LinkedIn Learn, and we hope to hear from you all soon.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.